So one before we start, I don't know if the message went through, but if somebody wants to use the laptop, which I encourage to, you should download the Solr version we're using currently. Little spoiler overhead. Please go to the site, and there's a link to the version I will be using during the presentation and later in coding session. In README there's a link, also there's an additional bit of information about the coding session itself. Excuse me? Here you go, sorry. Yeah, that's probably it's easier if I'm not standing in front of it. Okay. Okay, I think I'll everybody got this? Because probably a few people right now will be doing this exactly the same thing. Don't expect high downloads. But it will take some time before I get to the point of the presentation with the unit. Another organizational note. I got 3 slots. I think I will manage in 2. So if you weren't planning attending the last session today, you can start. Okay, but let's start from the beginning, right? Okay, so I welcome everybody here on this session. Session is called Graphs Everywhere. I wanted to add a known meme, but it didn't really fit the page. So I was left with my picture. What I want to talk today is about searching using graph algorithms, not about graph databases itself. There's I think many of you know the Lucene library, or at least services that uses like Solr and Elasticsearch. If not, I will do a short description. The Solr and Elasticsearch recently got the graph search capabilities. I will be focusing on the Solr ones because they are free. I will show you how to use them in live coding session, which you can follow. I will describe in a minute what tools are needed. Okay, so let's get started. So first of all, I'm Zbyszko. I'm currently a developer at Spartus working on Atlassian products. Previously, I worked for Allegro for a few years. I didn't really know how to introduce myself, so that will be basically it. What we'll talk about? First of all, I want to describe to you how Lucene works, what it is actually, what Solr and Elasticsearch are. I will not go into great detail. I will not go into any details at all, almost. I will just provide you some information, some background, what the tool is, what it's for, and why it's so good to use graph capabilities of those. Then I will briefly describe the history of how did we get there, how did we get from full-text searching, which Lucene is all about, to graph searching capabilities. I will mention the Elasticsearch graph capabilities only briefly, and then we go into much more detail into Solr capabilities, followed by examples. So, like I said before, this is a link to the page which for you guys who are using laptops will probably be interesting. Since I see that there are a few of you, I will briefly describe what you can see there. One second. Okay. You probably don't see anything, right? So, please forgive me. I will sit for this one. First of all, there are links necessary for our coding session. Well, actually, we need only one piece of software. That is external software. It's Solr. Once you install Solr on your laptops, there's this useful link called I have here, which will allow us to execute some queries from the visualization application. And then we will go, once we get to examples, we'll go through commands that will allow us to create some collections, feed them, and similar. So I will not go through all of them right now. Let's just, you guys who want to participate in session, by coding, by executing queries, please just download Solr and look at the second link that will provide you how to allow course connections with Solr. So let's get back to presentation. Okay, so I used the word Lucene a few times, so yeah? The same should work also. I think so, at least. I didn't have any Windows to test it on. I did have Linux. That was actually from my Mac. So on Linux they work. On Windows they should also work. A few years ago I worked with Windows version of Solr. Apart from the, you know, Windows specific directory structure and so on, it should work just the same. If not, we'll find a way to make it work somehow. A note here, if you want to ask questions at any time, please do. We don't have to wait for the end of the session for answering. So please do if you want to. Okay, so Lucene. I already mentioned Lucene a few times. First of all, a little quiz. Who of you work with Lucene or Solr Elasticsearch or something similar? Okay, so it's fortunate that I made some time to work on the presentation regarding Lucene, because I was afraid I wouldn't be needing this. So, what is Lucene? Another quiz: did any of you try to search for text in normal relational database like Postgres or maybe Postgres right not right now, but MySQL or Oracle? So you know the like queries and so on. They're horrible mostly. Postgres has some tooling that allows us for different type of searching, but mostly doesn't really work for databases. It's not the way they are created, right? So the need for the different kind of full text search arose at some point. And thus the few libraries, for example, Lucene was created. What's the difference between Lucene and the other engines that hold the data is that Lucene is dedicated to this full text search mechanisms. What does it mean? I will describe in a minute. But basically, it allows us to search for the in the text data information we need. For example, we need some information about cats. It will find us documents that contain cats, kittens, pussies, and so on. Which would be pretty hard for the other kind of database, because you know it would be hard to match any all synonyms and similar. So Lucene. That's the main point of Lucene, but of course it's not only that's not the only thing it does. It also allows for exact matches. Normal documents in Lucene contain more than one field of data inside, so it can contain full text like descriptions, mails, messages, and so on. But it can also contain information that is filterable, like gender, like email, and so on. So we can hold both informations inside of Lucene and create queries that will use both of the informations at the same time. So how does it work? First of all, like I said, we are searching documents. So the documents, for us to be able to search for the documents itself has to be indexed, that's the keyword here. They must be indexed into Lucene index. That's how it's called. So, how is it processed? We have a document that describes a kitty. It can describe a kitty, a kitten, cat, maybe some cats, pussy, or something similar. The kitty is gorgeous. So that's the I don't know topic subtitle of the document, and the rest of the document is this beautiful kitty here. So, cat is gorgeous, can be a cat, kitty will be translated to cat, because we do not want to hold all those informations. We want to have something that we will be able to quickly match for. So what Lucene can do, it can change all those words that were indexed from, for example, kitty, cat, and so on, to a single word, the cat. So what we have here is called synonym filtering. It's basically a process of using a dictionary data to get, I don't know, the base form of a word and so on. So it doesn't work only for synonyms, it also works for different word forms and so on. The second word is not indexed here. Why? Because you can also have Lucene use a filter called stop words filter to eliminate the most common words. Nobody uses is as a search term, and if it's in the site, it's a search term, it's mostly irrelevant for our search. It doesn't make the results any better. So next we have word gorgeous. You can see it's capital letters and three exclamation marks. Well, that's not very useful too. So we can index it in a different way. Here we have something different than in the first part of the query. There's a pointer. Oh yeah, there's. So instead of one word gorgeous, we have gorgeous, pretty, nice, and the list goes on. So it's similar to the first part where we can change many forms to the one. We can expand the single word to its all of its synonyms, like we did here. Once we have all those informations, we pack it into the index and send it to be saved. One interesting thing here is that it's the index in Lucene is called inverted index. So in most databases you have like IDs pointing to some documents, to some data. Here you have a completely different thing. You have some data for, in this case, those words here, pointing to document ID. So it's different way around. Of course, we can have more than one document. It would make no sense if we had only one, which would also contain words like cat, like gorgeous, like pretty, and something similar. What in the Lucene does, it's very simply, it saves those words called tokens, called terms, and points from those to documents in the index. So if you, for example, want to search for cat, it will be very easy because we already have the links for all the documents that are there. Okay, that's how indexing works. Well, let's go to searching then. Searching works pretty much this, yeah? That's right. Yeah. Well, we'll get back to this. The great thing about Lucene is that it's highly adaptive to the. I mean, you can use different form of different kinds of filters, tokenizers, and so on. There are tons of libraries, the plugins for Lucene that allows you, for example, to process, for example, Polish language. In this example, there are, I think, two or three implementations of stemming or lemmatization procedures. That's the ways to create some common form from different words. We have stempo, we have morphologic, and I think there was one more, I forgot the name. So every language, probably not everyone, but most of them, has their own plugins for Lucene that allows us to analyze those words. Of course, it gets much harder at some point, for example, in Korean or Chinese languages, where the words are not separated at all. So filters in themselves are not enough. We can do something with this too. The example I'm showing here is based on the standard tokenizer. Tokenizer is a part of a process that divides a block of text into tokens. So it's easy in the languages that use standard notation, like spaces, like dashes, and so on. That's easy to do. Of course, in Korean, it's much different. It's much harder. Word is formed from a single sign, for example. So there are different tokenizers for them too. for Korean language and so on. So there is a lot of plugins that allow us a highly customizable process of analyzing the data before they go into index. Does that answer your question? Okay, so next step is searching. To search, we have to do basically the same thing. We also, when we search, we also get like this block of text. It's usually much, of course, shorter than the documents in the index. And we also have to analyze them to query the index itself. Why? Because the querying in Lucene is basically comparing two strings together, like equals. So if we don't find an exact token we have here, we will simply not find the correct document. Why is it done this way? Because it's extremely fast. At least it's as fast as can be when searching for the full documents. And in the best, in the worst case scenario, all of the documents are being checked, or at least all tokens. Like I said, we have tokens, not document. We browse through tokens, not from to documents, and all of those are being checked during the search. Of course, there are some caching procedures implemented in both Lucene and Solr and Elasticsearch, but the basic case is that the Lucene just goes through every document, every token, and then through every document to check for the matches. So what we basically have to do is we have to get those words in the side of a query and bring them to the same format we have inside of our index. So that's not maybe a very creative example here, but as you can see, we have a kitty, so we move it to cat. Like I said, it's basically the same process. It doesn't have to be identical. For example, if we go back here, we have a thing called synonym expansion here, right? So every word gorgeous was translated to gorgeous, pretty nice, and probably some few other words. But we don't have to do the same thing here. If we have nice, we don't have to create every synonym token for this, and it's mostly doesn't it mostly is done this way. Why? Because every part of this analysis takes time. Of course, it's some kind of calculation, some kind of transformation. So synonym expansion is also this. Every new token inside of this also prolongs the process. So the best thing here would be just to create, to have all of the synonyms inside of the document and just single word without any synonym expansion here to process. Actually, we could have the same thing with kitty. If we just save every synonym of cat here, wouldn't also need to do this thing, right? Because kitty would be already in the document itself. So here we have a query. We have after the analysis process, we have three new tokens, very nice and cat. Let's say that's all of the query we provided. There, of course, can be different aspects to the query, some filtering done, some additional queries, and so on. But let's start with a simple case. So we have a few probably matching documents in the index. We have previously added nice cat, not that nice cat, and very nice dog. So we want to find out which one suits the best, right? So here in the first case we have two matches, nice and cat, so that's a contender. We then have ugly cat, so only cat matches, that's only one token. And here we have very nice dog. So we have a problem, right? Because clearly when you look at the query, this one should be, by common sense, be better matched than this one, right? You can clearly see that matching cat is much more important than matching very, right? And that's just the way it works in Lucene. So we had two matches, nice and cat, and in the second case we have very, very and nice. So Lucene bases its scoring method on two factors. Put it simply, first factor is quite simple. We have if the more of the tokens there are in the single document, the document is being scored higher. So if we would have more of cat words inside of a document, it would go up. So the same case is from of course for the very every different token here, but it also checks if how common the term is inside of a whole index. So in this case, let's I know it's some assumption which I didn't describe here, so I'm cheating a little bit, but in all the index, let's say there's a much more of this index than we saw here, because basing on this, we would say then the vary is more important than cat because there are two cats. But let's say there are more documents there, and they more closely resemble the English language itself. So when we have word cat, we want the frequency of how often word cat appears in the documents is much lower than word vary, which is a common word in English. So because of this, Lucene decides that cat is a better match token, and so nice cat wins the competition. Of course, that's we mostly find more than one document, so this scoring is applied to every document found, and then their sorting is being done. That's the default way how Lucene works, but that's not the only way. The algorithm I described is of course quite is a simplification. There are additional factors to it. But even though it was changed a few months ago to something different, it still follows the same base idea that high frequency the terms that are how the more often terms are in the side of the document is better, but we downgrade the score if the matched term to the document is a very common term. Okay. So, Lucene is a library. I don't know if I mentioned this. So, it won't allow you to start up something and just use it as from the get-go. It doesn't provide any sort of distributed operations methods, so no clustering, no replicas, and so on. It basically allows you to create index and search using many analysis forms, and that's it. That's not counting the few additional also analytic tools. You won't find anything there related to network and so on, with few slight exceptions. So it's the team working behind Solr maintained this status quo of its library for a long time, and I think they're doing a somewhat good job with this, even though that they are maybe not that objective about the subject. Why, I will tell in a minute. So, like I said, it's just a library, so we need something to run it on, to use the library to something to create some service. You can do it by yourself, of course. You can add the Lucene library to your application. You can just run it and with it, and that will be cool also. You will have to provide additional mechanisms like replication and so on if you need it. But you don't have to. There are few technologies that already use Lucene for this stuff. The first service that was created is called Solr. It's currently on version 6.2.1. It was created, if I remember correctly, something in the middle of 2000s. What it adds to Lucene is that it allows for replication, for master-slave configurations, for cloud configurations using Zookeeper. Also provides you with ways to describe the document with schemes, which Lucene does not. Allows you to pre-configure some analytic chains, and many more things. The tool, like I said, is more than 10 years old, so as you can imagine, it added a few features along the way. What happened in the meantime is that Lucene and Solr from version, I think, 3.4 has a same version scheme. The team works quite closely with each other, Solr and Lucene team. I think you can basically say they're from the same company. And then I think one and a half year ago, even the repos were joined together. So if you want to download Lucene, you have to download Solr also. That doesn't mean that the other tools have problem working with Lucene. A team that works on Lucene is aware of of needs of our whole organization and of all other open source tools, and they work quite closely with them too. What it entails, the Solr always uses the newest version of Lucene. You can for Elasticsearch, it was not true for many years. It will be true with the newest version, but they will not be able probably to keep it for much longer. But Lucene and Solr are always deployed together. They always have the same version, so it's probably more compatible tool. But both Lucene and Solr have functionalities that the other one does not provide. In case of Solr, it's quite a lot of them. So, Solr is not the only one. The Elasticsearch, you could say it gained quite a good momentum. It's extremely popular right now. It's not only newer, but it also was designed with different ideas in mind. Like the Solr wasn't distributed from the get-go, at least not in the masterless form of way. Elasticsearch was. With this, also, it has much nicer REST API, at least from my in my taste. It had it from the first version. And the Elasticsearch itself is not the only tool that Elastic, that's the company that created Elasticsearch, is currently called. It's the only tool that's stuck. Some of you probably heard about Kibana. Did you hear about it? So Kibana is also the tool from Elastic, and Elastic plus Kibana plus Logstash and a few other tools form the thing called Elastic Stack. It was previously called ELK because Elasticsearch, Logstash, and Kibana. They then tried to add B from Beats, what was Belk, and Belk didn't sound this fun. ELK B didn't sound right too, so they just dropped the ELK and went with the Elastic Stack. I will not show many. I won't show probably nothing about Elasticsearch. The topic of today's session is graph search. And Elasticsearch, although has one, unfortunately this one is commercial. So I wouldn't feel good showing a commercial solution, even if it has 1 month trial period. But fortunately, Solr created its own graph solutions, and you will be able to see them today. Well, almost see them. So, I think that's the full extent of what we need from Lucene and other tools before getting into things. If you have something will be unclear, please don't hesitate to ask me. I probably forgot about half thing I should say. Why do we even do this? Because we can. There are already relations, not documents. So we don't have. It's not that we just came to an idea that there are some forms of relations between our data, and we want to see what they provide. That's something normal. And graph searching is an easy form to extract those relations, extract those informations from our document set. So there wasn't. I don't think there was a driving force stemming from full text searching itself, but more because of. Analytic phase we currently have with the data, right? The big data, the statistics, and so on. That's a hot topic right now. So it's nothing strange that both Solr and Elasticsearch decided to leverage the data they already have. It didn't start here, of course. Like I said, Lucene was created with full text searching in mind. So was Solr. But full text searching is a form of analysis, of course, but that's not the only possibility. So later we had faceting and aggregation. Faceting is basically a form of aggregation. Faceting entails grouping documents in some form of properties, for example, gender, some category, and so on. So. We have something like this in Solr. In Elasticsearch, it's called aggregation. I won't go into detail about those. If you want to see something more about aggregation, I recommend you see my talk from the previous year. I was talking about aggregation in Elasticsearch. There are, of course, additional forms of, after that came the additional forms of statistics, mostly through Elasticsearch aggregations, like some form of metrics, max, min, and some much more complicated. And then we have current stage, current and newest rage in analysis of data. So relation, I call it relationship exploration, but it's basically just graph searching. You probably heard about graph searching already. If you search for somebody on LinkedIn, for example, or Facebook, you'll get results that will be sorted in some form, some factor based on the graph search, for example, to your closest friends and similar. So we already, some of companies already use those. They have, of course, their own proprietary solutions for those. It was only a matter of time before Solr and Elasticsearch got those too. Okay, so why would we even consider doing this? That would be a main question here. Actually, as a point zero here, I wanted to Okay, that's all. So I wanted to add this point zero to this slide, which I promise I will not do, so I will just say it. Main argument for me was that it was a new toy to exploit. Why does it matter? Because of this, of the first point here. Most of us, at least at some point, already did or will be using some form of full text search. If you have your website or something similar, you probably want to give your users ability to search through your pages and something similar. In many businesses, that's necessary to do, in e-commerce, in blogging, and social networking. So full text searching is a must. So it's those tools are quite mature and available from the get-go. And we do not have to do anything to get those capabilities here. Well, that's not true, but there's an asterisk here. I will go into that in a moment. Second, TF-IDF. I don't know, I probably didn't explain this abbreviation. TF is a term frequency. IDF is inverse document frequency. This is the mechanism I was talking to you about that allows us to score the documents. We go up if a document contains more terms. If we go down, if a term that is matched is quite popular. So we also have some form of those kind of sorting in our in Solr, Elasticsearch, I think, too. And that's actually the same point from a first, so it's already there. You can just go ahead and use it. And if at least I hope to show you that it's quite easy to just start using it. But let's be clear here, right? If you are just focused on graph capabilities, like that's your main point here, you do not need anything else. Lucene, Solr and Elasticsearch are not the way to go. That's the graphs that are created inside of a query, right? When you query the Solr Elasticsearch, you get the graph that will be shown is generated during the process. So if you want to leverage just graphs, go for Neo4j, for example. It's a database that is single focus is to be a great graph database. There are a few others too, but I must say I like Neo4j best. So, how does Elasticsearch and Kibana does it? The module is called Graph. It's a plugin for both Elasticsearch and Kibana. Some of you told me that you know Kibana. You probably also know that it's coupled with Elasticsearch. For every Kibana, there is an Elasticsearch that serves data to it. It's a quite simple query, similar to gather nodes I will be describing in the few minutes. It allows us to do a form of controlled walking, similar to what I will be describing. And like I said, unfortunately, it does come at the price. So like I said, I won't be going into much detail for now. If you want to know more about it, search XPack or Graph, Elasticsearch Graph, and you can get more information about this. The nice thing is we have this. So there's a visualization from that is first party. We unfortunately don't have this in Solr. But in Solr, it's free. So that's probably more important. And creating a visualization is not that difficult. I will show you a simple one I created. So what does Solr do? Solr actually has two ways of traversing the graph. So what it lacks in visualization, it has a sheer number of possibilities. First form is simple graph query parser. Graph query parser in Solr is a way to create different ways of querying the data. So it's also you can also create plugins for this. It's actually a graph query parser plugin. So it's just a different form of querying the data. It's an experimental feature. You will hear this word a lot, unfortunately. Because of the experimentalness of this feature, it works currently only for single node, single core applications of Solr, which is quite limiting, to be honest, because not many of those are around here. So, but it's due to change, at least if we base our knowledge on the comments inside the code. There is no first-party visualization. The screen is from the third-party visualization created by Rafał Kuć, is quite known in the Lucene circles. I didn't manage to get it to work, so I will not show it. Probably should work something like this. And the main problem for visualizing anything, it does not track the edges of the traversal. So what Rafał actually did was to get the document and find the edges by himself. So it just like I told you about LinkedIn or Facebook. It's just like it works like this. So we can create a query that will find the graph that's created from the sum depth of traversal. I have an example in this in a minute, so we will see what I mean. Like I said, there are two ways of doing things, and the second, I think, much more fun, is called streaming expressions. Streaming expression is a new addition to Solr, which allows us for creating form of chains of functions. It's also an experimental feature. Surprise here. There's also no first party. There's a mistake here. This word does not exist here. There's no first party visualization, but despite what my slide says, there is. It does track edges of the traversal if you want it to. So it allows us to create some form of graphs. I have an application I wrote that will fortunately allow us to see how it looks like. So let's start from the first way of creating graph data. It was called Graph Query Parser. So that's a very simple query based on this plugin. It will create a graph from of Susan Gardner's friends. And one word here is that I provided you with a link that also contains the generators for those collections. So this is actually one of the collections you can see on the link itself, from the GitHub page. Okay, so let's see how does it work. So first of all, what it does, it looks for the initial nodes. The initial nodes are like a form of a starter kit. It's a normal query that will use to get some data and start our graph from this place. So like a start node. I showed the simple version. So we are just looking for the document with email field Susan Gardner at example.com. And we found it. It's right here. Do you see the fragments that are important?
Przepraszam bardzo, jeśli mogę, bo w tym momencie jest 10-minutowa przerwa w programie, jeśli moglibyśmy zrobić tą przerwę.
Dobra, okay. So after the break I'll continue with the example and then finally get to the examples itself. Okay. So we found the initial document. We want to see what friends does Susan Gardner has. It's works a bit counterintuitive for me. I don't know if you find it the same way, but we search for the fields. Two describes the fields we are using to collect the data, and from is the source field in the documents itself we are searching for. So we check for Emily's friends. Those are Cindy Hunt and Dallas Herrera. Oh yeah, when we currently we live in the world that you can be friends with someone and someone doesn't have to be friends with you. Sorry, harsh reality. So we then search by this document here. We find Cindy Hunt and Das Herrera. So here they are, right? That's MaxDev1. MaxDev1 defines how far are we going to go when searching for the next documents. So here we have MaxDev1, but we can change this. Sorry for the, I thought it would look better, but it is. So Cindy Hunt didn't have any friends. That's the problem. But Dallas Herrera is quite popular. He has four friends, at least four people he considers a friend. And we found those two. So current results we see here that are those documents. But of course we can go further. I think the mechanism here is quite understandable. We just go to friends and search the people that have emails as the same as the friends on the list here, and we go on and on. To search for the whole of the graph, we have to change this value here to -1. It basically tells us that we search the whole graph. So, not to show you I'm not lying about this, I will just demonstrate how it works. I hope it. So, a little side note about the examples. Like I said, here are some links that for Solr and for course in Solr, but we also have to create the collections itself. Creating collections in Solr isn't easy. Fortunately, they created a way to bootstrap us, and like mostly in Solr, the bootstrap our example is the most common bootstrapping way of Solr collections. So the command here in the Solr directory to create Solr instance for cloud is bin/solr, so Solr executable, -e, which stands from example, and cloud is one of the examples. It will allow you to create, you can input the parameters for the collection, for the server. I urge you to use single replica, single node, and so on. It's much easier for our case. Of course, you don't have to. If you would ever stop the Solr, because this will start the Solr, you can stop, once you stop it, it's done this way, you have to do this to get back to your examples. Yeah? Oh, and you couldn't, sorry, guys. Yeah, so. Sorry for that. Okay, here we have it, bin solr minus ecloud. It creates the example. It also asks you for the name of the collection. You can provide any of the collection names I have here in this document. You can create your own as you wish. The feeders that I provided will only work for the collection names that are described in this document here. So, for example, the one I showed before is social users collection. Here you have a schema for it. For your convenience, I created a postman method calls. So you can just run this, and you'll have a schema for every collection I have here. So. It uses the standard port that was provided during the creation of the example, so 8983. If you change this, you have to also change it in Postman. But if you went by defaults, you should be able to just run it and see the same results I have here. So, so like I said, steps to start Solr are start with this command. It will create the example from example cloud. It's cloud is a template. Once you do that, please remember setting the correct collections and number of replicas and nodes to one. Once you do that, if you want to create a collection after another collection after that, you use this line. It's actually this command is actually a shorthand for the few others. Like I said, creating collections isn't easy in Solr, and mostly it's better just to use this. At least that's my experience. If you do something wrong and you want to delete collection, you can use this command. So delete -c is the parameter of a collection name. And once you create a collection, you have to use one of those to create the schema. Why is it important? Solr actually has a form of schemeless indexes, collections, but there are some defaults that that are not really great, for example, because it creates a schema based on the first document indexed, so you cannot know if you want to want this field to be analyzed or not, and so on. In both cases, the query parser plugin and getter nodes, we still have to, streaming sessions. We have to use, for the traversal, we have to use fields that are not being analyzed. Like creating it would analyze fields would take much more time, and people who created this didn't see the need to do this. So if we would use the default way the Solr creates documents, all the, of the text fields would be analyzed, so it's not good for us. So like I said, let's see the first example. So the first example was the query parser plugin. If you installed the plugin correctly, Solr collect correctly, please work. Okay, you will see this. You can go to the localhost 8 localhost 8. It's, you don't see, you won't see shit here. 8983. So the port, if you go there, you'll get the standard admin page. Believe me, in the lower, higher resolution, it looks better. So to query for the data we just discussed, you have to change the collection, social users collection was called. Oh yeah, and once you, of course, once you create the collection, you want to see actual data there. There's a Java application. One moment. Here we go. So there are a few Java applications that just executed by executing the main method. Probably using something like IntelliJ would be easiest way to do it, which feeds the data into the system. We have a few collections here. One I will currently be using is social users. What does it does? It takes, I think, 50 emails from a file provided inside of the repo, and it randomizes the friends' data. So results may vary in, when we check if you execute the similar queries by yourself. If we want, it won't produce the same data because, like I said, it's randomized, so random number of friends and random friends. There are other collections I will describe once we get to the examples itself. Okay, so let's get back to the query. So that's the query we have here. It's a similar one we I have on my slides. Let's actually start from. It's currently has max dev one, so you should, you see Susan Gardner here, Cindy Hunt, and Dallas Herrera. That's the three documents from my example. So first document found was Susan Gardner, that was the one here, and the next were found based on the friends field here. It's a multi-value field with two emails, and those emails are here. So it actually looks like a simple join, right, at this point. So we can go deeper. Oh, let's go to two. And this one would be still be join, but not that simple. You can create join from join and so on. But the thing that you would probably wouldn't do with join is that you want to get a whole friends network of this one person. So you just go with max dev minus one. You can see it clearly, but I can see it from here clearly, but that probably doesn't help much. Every time I change the query, it's also reflected here. So if you don't see it here, you can see it here. Number found was 50. So whole of her network consists of 50 people. We have actually 10 here because we have pagination, but let's see them all. And this is it. So we have our friends network. everybody for Susan, everybody who's in the Susan Networks, Susan Gardner's friends, on all of their friends are here. So it's quite nice to see, but it's I do not find this as the, as practical as the second way the queries work. But it allows us for creating this whole graphs at one at a single step. So we just get there minus one, and we have everything connected to it. So if you, for example, want to search for some through every people that somebody have contacted directly or not, it's a way to go. You probably would find many other examples how to use it. I prefer the second way, which I'll describe now. But it's worth to know that there is a way to just get all of the graph. Like I said, there is no way to see the ancestors, so how it's connected with each other. The tool I tried to use, unfortunately, I couldn't. It's just searching through the documents and searches for the matching fields. So, for example, it will find Susan Hunt. You can always search for Susan Hunt in the whole of the document and find it and link it with it. So it's useful. It's quite nice, but not that useful, to be honest. So let's get to something in my mind much more useful for the examples. Let's finish with this. Okay, so it's correct on your preview. So there are more parameters. There's a traversal filter, which allows you to modify the graph we're searching through. It's actually a quite powerful feature, which uses the Lucene capabilities. I will show something about this in the next examples. There's a similar parameter in streaming expressions. You can, if traversal filter is nothing more than a filter query that limits the search of a node. So you have this initial query that finds you documents that start the graph, and you have traversal filter which is being executed on every stage. So every time you do a traversal, it first, when it finds the documents, and it limits the documents to those matching this filter. For example, if we would have, and we didn't, unfortunately, in this document's gender, for example, we using traversal filter we could limit ourselves to only female friends of Susan Gardner, for example.